He was impressed first by the wind. It struck him full in the face as it rushed, strong and troubled. It crinkled the leaves of the cottonwood trees and whistled softly through the tall grass on the gentle slope. When he reached the top of the slope, his mouth gaped wide at the scene which stretched before him. It was as if it were a planet, and he were the only inhabitant. He was called Panhandle Man, and it was sometime before 1200 A.D. The place he had come to was what we know as the Great Plains. It had been a vast inland sea, shallow and warm, with high mountains on the west, far higher than today's Rockies. There were drenching rains in those days, and the water washed down the mountains, filling the sea with their soil. Thousands of years passed. The rain stopped, the sun grew hot, the sea dry, leaving behind a plain of mud. A carpet of grass then crept over the mud and held firm against the wind. It was time for man. Panhandle Man was a farmer, and he fought the Great Plains wind and the Great Plains sun, as countless other farmers have since. He fought, and he lost, and he moved on. Other men followed, men who were hunters, hunting the millions of buffalo that roamed through the belly-deep grass. The hunters succeeded because they let the plains alone. In their primitive wisdom, they knew enough to let nature run its course. No plows ripped into the protective sod, and the grass grew tall. The wind and the sun did not drive them out as it had all the others. The plains could not beat the hunters, but other men could. The white man brought his cattle to the belly-deep grass. Texas, like all of the South, lay destitute in 1865. But unlike the rest of the Confederacy, Texas had a crop for market. And to get it there, the cowboys started it walking. The Great Plains became a great highway of beef. From Texas to the railroad junctions at St. Louis, St. Joseph, and Kansas City, the beef walked, and as it walked, grew fatter on the buffalo grass. The white man's cattle could live just as well as the red man's buffalo on the plains, and since there was more than enough grass to go around, the red man saw no reason to object. At first, the herds just passed through, stopping only long enough for the men to rest. But then the white man decided that it would be better business to grow his cattle closer to the railheads, so he made deals with the red man. It was the beginning of the end for the hunters. It was time now for the cattle barons. What the plains had failed to do, greed and dishonesty did do. And for 20 years, the cattlemen had the plains to themselves. There was money in beef, and on God's greatest pasture, beef was easy to grow. To make it even easier, the railroads pushed into the heart of the land. With the railroads, too, came the laborers who began to speculate on the farming potential of this pasture. Their picks and shovels bit into the rich, deep soil. And their instincts told them that more than grass would grow here. It wouldn't be long before the cycle would begin again. The farmers were coming back to the plains. It was Panhandle Man all over again. Thank you. The superstitious Indians hated the plow. They said that plowing turned the earth upside down and ruined everything. They didn't know that a fine, rich soil lay just beneath the protective prairie grass, and they couldn't understand that with just enough rain, the Great Plains would grow almost anything. The Indians didn't know the plows had found the promised land. Of all the seed that went into the fresh plowed plains, nothing grew like the wheat. Rich, deep soil, warm sun, level land. When there was enough rain, the wheat was a summer miracle. When the Great War of 1917 came, the Great Plains were ready. Rain was plentiful. Crops were good. In most of the world, the wheat was being trampled in battle or parched by drought. In America, the wheat was good. There was plenty of it. For a starving world, wheat was ammunition. The word went out from Washington, grow more wheat. Wheat would win the war. The Belgians were starving. The French were starving. The world was at balance, and wheat would tip the scales. Government agents toured the plains, urging farmers to plant more wheat. New prairie land was open to the plow. Liberty quotas were set for every state. The price of land went up. The price of wheat went higher. Not to grow wheat at any price was treason. Not to grow it at a profit was crazy. The cry for wheat was greater than the plains farmers could fill, even with abundant rain and virgin soil. But now came new tools to do the job, new plows, new harvesting machines, and the greatest of them all, the gasoline tractor. The cry was more wheat. The president called for more production. The secretary of agriculture pleaded for more acres in wheat. Every available piece of ground was turned under and planted. Land speculators sent out recruiters to bring more farmers into the plains. Suitcase farmers who saw their land only once a year at harvest time. They sprang up everywhere. Tenant farmers opened wide stretches of plains grassland. It wasn't enough, though, to feed the entire world, though it was a passionate cry. Finally, the war was over. Came a time after World War I when the nations of the earth regained their fields and farms, when their own crops came back and they no longer needed the wheat of the American Great Plains. But now the plains farmers had new problems. To beat the falling prices, they planted more wheat, bought more machinery to cut costs, then to pay the bills, planted more wheat. And every year the price went down. Now, too, the inevitable cycle of the plains was at work. Grain was growing scarce. Dry years were more frequent. Crops were slimmer. Prices went lower still. The farmer's answer was plow and plant, a race that finally ended in 1929. The spring of 1934 was dry. Farmers had planted their wheat in the dust that fall and waited. But the winter had passed without snow. Spring began with no clouds, no rain, and a naked sun in a naked sky. Topsoil was like powder, for the land had been dry for a year and a half. Plains farmers began to suspect that this was no ordinary drought. On the 14th day of April, they learned for sure. Every field in western Kansas began to move at once. Torrents of wind raced down from the north. Visibility shrank from miles to yards. Toward noon in Kansas, the wind seemed suddenly to roll, picking up great chunks of earth, throwing it into the air. Soon a monstrous cloud was rolling southward toward Texas. Whole towns were engulfed before their citizens could get inside and shut the doors. The cloud of dust stretched from east to west as far as the eye could see. As it approached, there was a great rush of wind, then darkness, total, utter darkness. Men fell to their knees in prayer. Mexican railroad workers in Dalhart, Texas, thought the world had come to an end and searched for a priest. Thousands of excited ducks and geese fled before the storm, the weaker ones fluttering to earth in its midst. Dead jackrabbits littered the plains. A small boy in Kansas lost his way and suffocated in the sand. A farmer wandered for hours in a 10-acre garden before bumping into his house. Dust sifted into houses. Food turned black. Sparks flew between pieces of metal. Men were shocked when they touched the plumbing. Automobiles shorted out on the roads. A locomotive was derailed by dust. 350 million tons of topsoil were on the move. By nightfall of April 14th, the dust covered Chicago and the Ohio River. Planes were grounded, and by the second morning, the entire seaboard was blanketed. The sun disappeared for 5 hours in New York. In Washington, the dust seeped into the White House and covered the president's desk. 300 miles at sea, a ship radioed back for an explanation of the dust which covered its decks. The storm did not stop. It only paused. 61 dust storms raked the panhandle of Texas in 1934, and the rains did not come. The wheat harvest was bleak indeed. Most of the crop was worthless. 4 million acres were abandoned in Oklahoma and Texas panhandles. Cimarron County in Oklahoma did not harvest a single grain. And still the wind blew. In 1935, Oklahoma rainfall fell 45% below normal. Towns bought water at 50 cents a barrel. At Amarillo, visibility was less than 1 mile the entire month of March. Pneumonia cases shot up 50 to 100%. Doctors canceled operations because they could not sterilize their instruments. One storm, the last of March, scooped out twice as much soil in a single day as men dug out of the Panama Canal in 7 years. 5 million acres of winter wheat were destroyed. Before 1935 had blown itself out, 850 million tons of topsoil had been swept off the plains. All summer long and into the autumn, the wind blew. Dust piled higher around the barnyards and drifted into abandoned houses. Outside of Dalhart, Texas, two crows were found making a nest of barbed wire in the branches of a dead tree. The Great Plains were about as dead as they would ever be. Sometime in 1935, the farmers began to give up. The tenant farmers started first, of course. With no ties to their land, they just packed up and moved on. Thank you. But after three successive years of crop failure, of dust, and drought, and disappointment, regular residents joined too. The summer of 1935 found many of them driving out of the Dust Bowl, their possessions atop a car or trailer. Bitter, dejected, poverty-stricken people. They were not the first to find the Great Plains a ruinous place in time of drought. Many others had learned the same sad lesson in 1913, 1894, 1886. The Great Plains have a rhythm. The rains fall. The rains do not fall. The rains fall again. The Indians, the buffalo, the sea of grass were part of this cycle, but they were gone now. Even the land turned upside down by the plow was going away. Only a fraction of the refugees were from Oklahoma, but they had to have a name. And so they became the Okies from the Dust Bowl, on their way out. The Great Plains were on their way back. No one thought to give a name to those who stuck it out, who refused to give up, though they saved the plains on their own. Men found the trees helped stop the dust, and they planted thousands. They found that plowing at right angles to the wind helped, and they sat on tractors burning government gasoline and eating dirt until they halted the blowing fields. Irrigation watered dry fields. Worthless wheat patches were turned back to grass, and it worked. But best of all, the rains came back. They say the harvest this year was the greatest in history. There is plenty of rain, more than enough. The climate is mild, and the soil is rich. Through such a land, there is hardly a limit to the riches a man can grow. They say the climate is changing out on the plains. There's more rain now, more than ever before. The old days of drought and dust are gone forever, they say, and it's easy to believe. But the plains have a memory longer than man and laws which he never repeals. Man has learned much on the plains, but the wind is still there. And when it blows, the dust stirs restlessly, waiting only for fools and their folly. And time.